Hi, I'm John the Engineer Turmel, and I put together the Gold Star team of MMPR, MMAR plaintiffs complaining about the new marijuana regime who want compensation for their losses and interim exemptions for personal medical use. Big demonstration tomorrow. I was hoping that I could have our people next door in the court getting this settled, but I filed 5 weeks ago, and they've managed to stall us off until past D-Day, so I've decided to really hit them hard by getting people to tomorrow's demonstration to file on through, file their statement of claims, because everything they need is within 2 blocks to get it done, and for $2, join our fight, now that they realize how John Conroy and his crew screwed us. 250 grand for what he's done so far? And he's only up to 88,000 so far? Suckers. Okay, update just before Health Canada's April Fool's demo tomorrow in Ottawa. Now, these are the statement of claims. The previous video explained how they work. The only thing that's new is that we found out they're only $2 to file instead of 50, and they can be filed online. Now, after we filed those, we filed notices of motion. The system works like this. You file your originating statement of claim for the relief you want, including the compensation for your losses. And then within that file, you can now file a motion for interim relief, where we ask for, note the words, an interim exemption for personal medical use. Now that's important because the Manson decision threw out John Conroy's request for an interim exemption because he asked for unlimited use. Didn't specify for personal use, so the judge said, no, can't give you that. But we're asking for just personal medical use. That's a proper limitation, I think. So, that's a notice of motion, and we were trying to get these into a general sittings with all of our people in Halifax, in Ottawa, in Toronto, in BC, where there were general sittings. Now, with general sittings, you have to file a motion 2 days in advance. And many of us got those done in time. So, now remember, general sittings, you can't have long, long motions, but we don't expect ours to be very long. It's pretty simple stuff. So, anyway, on March the 5th, I get a letter from the judge that says my motion is being not set for the general sittings. It's being sent down to special sittings, booking to the administrator to book me a special sitting. Then on March, on March the 6th, first of all, on March the 2nd too, I sent Health Canada an email. And I said, Health Canada's website says, various surveys published in peer-reviewed literature have suggested that the majority of people using inhaled or orally ingested cannabis for medical purposes reported using approximately 1 to 3 grams of cannabis per day. I said, could you tell me what peer-reviewed surveys they were? Anyway, no answer. 4 days later, March 6th, I sent another. I said, hey, I wrote you this message. Are you having any difficulty finding them? I can appreciate how the surveys you cited in the peer-reviewed literature must not be at your fingertips and quite hard to find. But 3 full days? We got a court case coming up where those valuable surveys will be needed. So, March the 7th, the Crown Attorney. Now, don't forget, we had a little bit of trouble originally. But anyway, on March the 7th, the Crown Attorney in Ottawa files a letter to the administrator asking the administrator to not schedule our hearings because they're too lengthy and inappropriate for general sittings. Now, how is he to know how long they're going to be? But anyway, that's what he asked for to the court administrator. Well, guess what? Same day. Now, don't forget. He faxed that to the court, but he couriered it to Ray and Tony Van Eeded so that they didn't get it Friday. They didn't know what was being asked on Friday. They couldn't respond on Friday. They got it on Monday. Friday afternoon, Chief Justice Crampton issues a direction saying what the Crown requested. Given all these numerous filings, it is ordered that they are going to all be stayed pending the decision of the motion in Allard, which is coming up on the 18th. Fine. 25 different files are stayed. And then, as well, all future ones of the same relief are stayed too. So anyway, on March the 10th, I wrote a letter of complaint about the Crown not serving it. Don't forget, Section 54 says that you got to make a motion for directions. And here these guys got a direction without making a motion by writing a letter to the administrator in the background to slip the judge a message of a direction they needed, and then they didn't send any service, proper service, to Ray or to Tony. Pretty dirty pool. So anyway, wrote a letter complaining about that. Anyway, nevertheless, nothing happened before that. Oh, but I also asked, fine, we don't mind being put off after the Allard case. They're going to cover 4 of our 26 issues, okay? We don't mind having 4 covered first, but we want in, we'd like, before Manson makes a decision in Allard, because we want to tell him about the 150-gram fraud, too, and, you know, other stuff as well. But as we'd like to be heard by Manson before he decides, right? So we have similar issues the judge said when he stayed us. The same issues he said. We got different arguments proving them. So we ask for, we want as soon as we can and to see Manson, and if not, at least before the 31st. Okay? At least before the expiry of everybody's exemptions. That's what we want. So that was my letter. Oh, March the 10th, Russell Barth in Ottawa got the media interested in the story because Russell said, I want a claim for what I'm going to have to pay that I can't afford if I have to go with the MMPR. And I said, yeah, great idea. What's that going to cost? Well, I don't know. He said, if you live to 80, I said, put 90, okay? So if you live to 90, you multiply your years, you multiply your grams per day times $15 a gram at Prairie Price's best stuff. And then ask the government for, how much is that over 42 years? $4 million. Okay, put it in. Now, the government might quibble, but that's what you want to cover your marijuana if you're forced to go on the MMPR. Why not ask? So now the new claims have that, the affidavits where you state your losses. As well, the latest affidavits have another one. I found out about people who shut down their grows. 12 guys in Simcoe had 700 plants and they shut it down. They lost a 90-day cycle before finding out they're authorized again. Well, I said, gee, put that in. How many plants did you destroy? Well, 700 in all. We got pictures. Good. 700 grand you want for sure. And then away they go. So anyway, I don't think they destroyed their pot, but their plants they may have. So that's the kind of relief we want to have. Anyway, big numbers. Russell Barth started that trend. So March the 14th now. I'm saying to myself, I ain't happy with this stay that's holding us back. So I decide I'm going to file a notice of appeal against an interlocutory judgment, which this is, within 10 days. So I go in on the 9th day, okay, I mean one day ahead of time with my notice of appeal. And when I get there, Her Majesty the clerk tells me, sorry, a direction isn't an order. It's not appealable. And I'm thinking to myself, whoa, you know, a direction ordering me stayed is not appealable, but an order directing me stayed is appealable. Something funny there. So anyway, at the same time, just about this time, the Health Canada decide to up the ante and they issue the thread about how they're going to report everybody to the RCMP if they don't send them their affidavit that they destroyed their pot. Thus, again, highlighting the destruct order that we have objected to in our statement of claim that John Conroy did not object to in his. Is he asking for compensation for the destroyed pot if his people have to destroy it? No, we are. So anyway, the RCMP thread is now making the news, scaring people even more. March 17th, that's when, the next day, I send in Ray. And I've now changed the notice of appeal from notice of appeal of the order, of the direction ordering my thing stayed. And I included now, under Section 53, it says that if in making an order, A judge may make directions. So, how do you make directions without making an order? Not possible. So, Her Majesty the Clerk was bluffing me. So I stuck that section right in to the next notice of appeal. And instead of me going in against all that resistance, I sent my brother in, Ray, in Ottawa. Okay? And he got in. So, wham, what's happening there? He got in, he got it, sent it north to the judge for directions. Fine. As soon as that happened, I mean, it's got past Her Majesty the Clerk, he went out and got Audiette McIntyre and Bella Becky, who also have statements of claim, and they filed their notices of appeal of their stay, too. So now there's three in Ottawa. Well, now I got Lawrence and Terry and Sam going in Toronto, and same day, same afternoon, and I could, too. I'm still on time one day. But anyway, so I don't want to have all the resistance, so I send Lawrence up to do the talking, and I say, Lawrence just mentioned that Ray's case and Ariette's and Bella's have all been sent up. Therefore, and they've all got stamped, received within the 10 days on time on another copy. Go get yours. And if they can, why can't you? Sure enough, Lawrence comes back, and they've all got their three stamped. They're in, sent for directions to the judge. Anyway. Me, I could have gone, snickered at Her Majesty the Clerk, but they screwed everybody who have now expired their 10 days, right? And that means that I, if I wait one more day, will have to file for an extension of time to file my notice of appeal with everybody else who got screwed by the short 10 days and would like to join me in the Court of Appeal. So now there's the kit for people on time, notice of appeal. And then there was the kit for the ins, and I put at the end of it. And then there was the kit for people who need an exemption, notice of appeal with an E. And therefore, I went in the next day, and I filed. Now, I need an extension of time. So, now, what's neat about that is, even if the other guys who are filing notices of appeal have difficulty, and there's some kind of a delay, okay, because whatever, they just hang on, don't do anything. They can't file their motions, but for interim relief. But if I make an application for an extension of time, that goes in automatically because I got no notice of appeal waiting to be filed to stop me, right? Motions for extensions of time don't need a notice of appeal because you're asking for one. And at the same time, I include and interim relief, okay? So I'm gonna get in with the extension of time and ask for the interim relief at the same time. Anyway, by waiting another day. And I did. And then Mike Spottiswood and Gerard Fox, who were also late with me, also filed the next day. So I think they're right. And then, of course, the neat thing is that Stephen Burrows, on the last day at 11 o'clock at night, he filed online a notice of appeal. And he got an answer from the lady saying, yes, the other six have been sent up for directions. And when I find out what happens to them, and if they get in, I'll let you in. Well, a few little while later, there was a direction from Justice Barnes, I believe, who said, oh no, that was telling me to wait. Justice Dawson okays the six. Okay, let their notices of appeal in. But not Stephen Burrows yet. So, and me, of course, we're asking to get in with the other six who are now officially in. But anyway, Stephen Burrows called up the registrar and said, well, what's going on? How come I don't get my appeal number like the other guys did? And she said, I don't know, but I got to find out. So nothing's happening. So he writes back again and says, look, they all got their direction. How come you ain't getting me one? So he still doesn't have his in. But technically, there are seven who got a right to be in there with three more coming. Court of Appeal. Now, what's interesting, well, let's continue on the stay now. All right. Now, on the 18th, there was the Conroy hearing. And on the 20th, Dawson okayed the 6th, let him in. On the 21st was the Conroy ruling. Okay, short digression to explain how Health Canada won everything they needed by getting their buddy, John Conroy, to do the same thing that their buddy Alan Young did back in 2003. In 2003, Terry Parker and I and Mark Paquette, we had motions to declare that the law had been invalid since Terry Parker Day because he wasn't exempted. And the exemption didn't work. And When we finally get it heard, October 7, 2003, we're now connected up with the Hintzig case. And you know what he's trying to do? They want to fix the exemption. Well, on the day Terry and I found out that the prohibitions had been dead for 2 years because the exemption hadn't worked, is the day Alan Young told Canada it was now fixed again and the prohibitions were back. Okay? So, get it through your heads that when the exemption doesn't work, the prohibitions are down. So what do you think of guys who keep trying to make the exemptions work and help Canada make the exemptions work? Well, that's exactly what Conroy has done here. Health Canada were on the ropes. Now, let's look at what would have happened if Alan Young hadn't gotten involved with his Hintzig case. Terry Parker would have proven the law had been invalid since Terry Parker Day, and with no fix of the MMAR, the law would have stayed dead. Now, if you condemn the MMAR, the law's dead. If you keep it alive, the law's alive. Well, now we have another situation. Now, what would happen if John Conroy hadn't done anything? What happens? Well, on April the 1st, after all the bluffs and blustering and stuff, April the 1st, Health Canada's got 1,500 keys in stock from their affidavit, and they're facing a monthly demand of 15,000 keys that's growing. So, on April Fool, everybody would have found out, and they would have all been able to report to their judges that these LPs, these eight guys, can't deliver. There's just not enough. They ain't even online yet. And guess what? With the MMPR declared insufficient because it couldn't provide any supply, the prohibitions would have been dead. On April Fool, if John Conroy hadn't saved it by getting them an extension of the MMAR. There was no condemnation of the MMPR. So, what did Health Canada win other than the extension that they really needed or they would have been screwed? Well, they got their cherished 5 gram a day max, 150 grams a month limit supply movement for people. They've been pushing this for 10 years, and that's where they push the fraudulent stats behind the 1 to 3 gram average. Besides, what kind of moron gives you an average 1 to 3, right? There's something fraudulent there when they can't give you one number for an average. So anyway, everybody's screwed by that now. And the final thing is that they managed to shut down a bunch of legitimate grow ops. And now the judge only extended the grow op licenses back to September. But everybody who shut down the week before, 2 weeks before the shutdown order, they didn't get their ATPs renewed. They don't get their grow ops back. So probably thousands of people were bluffed out of their grow ops when Health Canada didn't even have enough supply by John Conroy getting his few people left an extension. All right? So, extra time, 150 gram limit, shut all the small grows down until the big grows are ready. And then they just wipe everybody else out. And that is what Health Canada won with John Conroy going to fix their exemption regime to keep the law alive. Anyway, so now we now go back and we ask for March the 25th or the 26th. Okay, we want a date before, now that this is over. And we pick now, we want, you know, April 30th, the first few people, but we weren't getting an answer, so I switched it to April the 1st. Maybe it wouldn't be so bad being in court across the street from a couple of thousand protesters. So anyway, so I go in now that the Conroy decision is over, now that the Conroy motion's been settled, and I walk in and I emailed them my proposed notice of motion, the return of my motion for interim exemption. And I get a response email saying, the stay is still alive. Where's the actual, I don't need the actual wording, the stay is still alive. Really? Well, if I had originally read Justice Crampton's decision as staying it till the end of their action, I'd have really hopped. But I didn't remember that. So I went back and looked. And sure enough, in Justice Crampton's order, it says until the hearing of the motion. So what did I do? I went back and I now included in the notice of motion and an extra little blurb that said, since Justice Crampton said to the hearing of the motion, and since the motion has now been decided, right in the notice of motion, in case someone was stupid enough not to know. And again, I wasn't going to go in against the same people who just rejected me because the stay is still alive, their whole registry in Toronto thinks. So I sent Ray in Ottawa with the new motion to explain why the motion is now decided and he can now make a new one. And sure enough, it got sent up for directions, the motion for April the 1st. Then he went out and got Bella Becky and Dariette to file theirs. And then in Toronto, I went in and filed mine. And on Monday, we're going to have Lawrence and Sam filing theirs. And who else? Michael Spottiswood, I think, and Kevin Moore are going to be filing theirs. So the point is, where some people have asked for April the 1st still. As of tonight, I've changed the notices of motion that we'll be handing out at the demonstration to not ask for April the 1st, but to simply ask for your telephonic hearing for your interim exemption. Do everybody one at a time. So Ray got in, but anyway, now, tomorrow is the big demonstration in Ottawa, and I've been promising to whack them for a while with an offensive move, and that is the offensive move about the surveys and the fraud and the genocide. Now, Health Canada wrote me back finally on March the 17th, okay? 15 days after I asked for their peer-reviewed surveys. Here's what they said. Thank you for your emails regarding dosage information from marijuana as supported by peer-reviewed literature. Please consult the document, Information for Healthcare Professionals, available at this site. And for specific references concerning dosage of marijuana, please refer to page 24 of the document noted above. Well, I wrote them back. I said, I did check that document and found nothing on daily dosage averages. How about just answering the question and telling me where to look? Oh, instead of telling me where to look that it's not at, what studies in what peer-reviewed journals? And no answer now 2 weeks later. So Health Canada doesn't have any peer-reviewed journal articles they're proud of. So I went and checked. Now, I've changed my attack on the 150 grams since the information in the Allard decision. And even the judge admits this now. So it's not a 15 gram average that I worked out from their numbers. The judge points out it's 17.7. And if you do the numbers, it's 18.3. So 18 average, 18. And then they say, though the average for the population is 18, surveys say it's 1 to 3, and the judge bought this. All right, so the new affidavit, I've now included the stuff about the surveys, which I'm going to file. All right, I explain how it comes to the 18 grams a day, the judge said, and here's what the information for healthcare professional states. Minimum therapeutic dose and dosage range. Various surveys published in peer-reviewed literature have suggested that the majority of people using smoked or orally ingested cannabis for medical purposes reported using between 10 and 20 grams per week, or approximately 1 to 3 gram, and I put average 2, of cannabis per day. What's the average of 1 to 3, right? These clowns don't know how to figure it down to 2. Unless something's fixed in there, different weights. All right, footnote 165, footnote 277, and footnote 350. I said there's inherently something wrong with speaking of a 1 to 3 gram average. The average of the averages is 2 grams. Averages are not stated as ranges. They're a point, an average. The fact we've given a 2 averages suggests improper or incompetent statistical analysis. Footnote 65. Okay, now this is going to the RCMP. Clark, Ware, and these other guys. Patterns of cannabis use among patients with multiple sclerosis. Neurology, but the sample size was 144. Was calculated to detect an estimated prevalence of 10% with a 2.5% standard error. 25% standard deviation. Wow! That's how big they are when you've got small samples. Lots of error. So I say Clark's study only discusses single dose size. Okay? And says not a word about daily dosages at all. And results with the sample of only muscular dystrophy patients is hardly indicative of the average dosage for all other illnesses. 25% of the mean is a pretty big error due to the small n. Significance was set at 95% level. That's two standard deviations according to the statistics rule of 66, 95, 99.7, 2, 3, and 4 standard deviations. Footnote 277. Carter, Waite, and Tosha, Medicinal Cannabis, Rational Guidelines for Dosing. In informal surveys from patients in Washington and California, not peer reviewed, the average reported consumption ranges between 10 and 20 raw grams of cannabis per week, or 1.42 to 2.86 gram per day. Jeez. So I say Carter's study has informal surveys for its guesstimate, not peer-reviewed at all. Carter continues, our recommended doses are further reinforced by two studies that utilized smoked cannabis in a well-documented dosing regime. Chang and co-workers studied the effects of smoking 3.6 grams per day, containing 15%. Vince Guerra studied smoking cannabis dosed at 1.5 grams per day. These doses fall within medical cannabis guidelines in the Canadian medical system, who rely on them for their dosage. Get the circle? Chang's study on 3.6 grams per day can't be found by Google, but it can't tell us the average grams smoked by the general population. I forgot a G. By the general population, if everyone got 3.6 grams, that's the average they would sample, right? Neither can four Vince Guerra study on the effect of 1.5 grams per day. If everyone got 1.5 grams per day, that's the average they would sample, right? So there's no way the recommended doses are reinforced by two further studies that utilize cannabis in a well-documented dosing regime. They were fixed dosing regimes. Footnote 350, their last. Ware and Adams and Guy. The medicinal use of cannabis in the UK results of a nationwide survey. Blah, blah. Okay, Ware's survey gives no dosage averages at all. And even if it did, over half the survey quit for lack of access or affordability. With more than half having a hard time getting it. An artificially low average would be expected. Finally, on February 7, Health Canada's Todd Kane's affidavit, he'll be charged, in the Allard proceeding at paragraphs 30-31 says, Health Canada took significant steps to project demand and available supply for medical use, and it was off by a factor of 10 with supply. In anticipating demand, Health Canada took into account available information on numbers of individual licensed to use marijuana for medical purposes, so he had that. The upward trend in that number, he had that. The daily dosage amounts identified in the most current scientific literature. Oh, he had the actual 18 grams per day, but he decided to use the 1.3 from the scientific literature, average 2. Get it? He had 18, but we chose to use the 2 from the scientific literature. That's why he's off by a factor of 10. And 9. Okay, as set out in the information for healthcare professionals available online. So it was fraudulent for Health Canada to rely on the daily dosage amounts identified in the most current scientific literature and international practice around dosage, and not rely on the actual daily dosage prescribed from the available information on numbers of individuals licensed to use dried marijuana for medical purposes and total production licensed. Right? They got those two numbers, total production licensed divided by total licensees, right? 18 grams a day. And they use surveys that come up with two. Todd Kane continues. The information for healthcare professionals document at page 3 states that following the most recent update of this document, February 2013, a study was published in the Netherlands tracking data obtained from the Dutch medical cannabis program over the years 2003-10. Dutch patients, the study reported that in a population of 5,000 Dutch patients using cannabis for medical purposes, the average daily dose of dried cannabis used was 0.68 grams, two-thirds of a gram per day. Range 0.65 to 0.72. Get it? They gave a standard deviation, a range of 0.7 around the point, 0.07 around the 0.68. That means a second standard deviation will have 14, the third will have 21, the fourth will have 28, the fifth will have 35. That means they're all under one. The whole sample are under 1 gram a day. 5,000 is small. They could have had 35,000 and everybody would have been under the same bell curve. Under 1 gram. So, Google doesn't find Hazenkamp and Heerdink surveying the Netherlands, with the only mention being in Todd Kane's affidavit. Certainly not yet in any published journal. He continues, in addition, information from Israel's medical marijuana program suggests that the average daily amount used by patients was approximately 1.5 grams per day. Well, if you just said that it's millions to one against 1 gram per day in the Netherlands, how can you now say the average is 1.5 in Israel? Get it? Back-to-back stupidity. But I said, hey, a personal communication from Israel. Hey, Izzy, suggest a number. It's not a survey in a peer-reviewed journal on Israel's medical marijuana programming suggesting the average daily amount is 1.5 grams per day. Of the studies cited at Health Canada's Information for Healthcare Professionals page, one, Clark discusses single doses. Two, Carter has informal surveys, citing three, Chang, who studies fixed 3.6 grams per day, not different daily dosages. And four, Vince Segura, who studies 1.5 grams per day, again, not different daily dosages. Five, Ware doesn't mention daily dosages at all. Six, Hazenkamp isn't found. And seven, Izzy's suggestion shouldn't count. Now, I have a bell curve showing around the 0.68, okay? And how it's all between 0.82 and 0.54. Four standard deviations. 33,000 results should all be under there, and they only had five. No one's going to be out past the 0.85 or even 0.9, let alone one full gram in the Netherlands. Get it? With that range, they committed themselves. Anyway, so I said, presuming the Hazenkamp survey may exist, well, I then explain how that those ranges work. Yet, Health Canada cited the informal Izzy survey suggesting 1.5, which is way, way 24 standard deviations off. Okay. Ask an economist about that. I mean, a statistician. Didn't someone notice the two polls contradicted each other? Reputable polls cannot have one poll with double the average of the other. It's completely improbable that both surveys could be honest, random samplings of the general population consumption with the same parameters. Of course, they're different parameters. Sought to define the 150-gram limit for us, though. The actual Canadian mean of 18, and I put that one up there with 18, and that swings all the way up to 20 and down to 15, all right, with the same ranges. So, the actual means 18, and that would be 500 standard deviations off the Netherlands. Ooh, you know, 0.72 is one standard deviation, 0.35. Wow, 500 standard deviations for us to have 18, one guy, let alone an average of 40,000. Crazy, right? They got caught. So bell curve two shows the actual numbers. So actually, not one of the studies cited in Health Canada testimony backs up the proposition that the proper estimated daily average of averages is 2 grams per day in the face of actual admitted evidence that's 18 grams per day when self-produced. Now, one article in any peer-reviewed journal suggesting daily dosage of 1 to 3 grams per day, average two, to validate the 5 gram per day, 150 gram per month limit imposed by the new MMPR. None. Off by nine. I had asked the court below to allow me to have our motion for the same relief on far more issues, also heard by Justin Anson, before he made his decision in Allard, and I was refused. In his decision, Manson stated on the effect of the 150 grams, I bide 150, oh, he said, the new limit of 150 is based on an average of 1 to 3. And I say that's 2, remember? I guess the judge doesn't know how to do an average of 1 to 3 either. Of medicinal marijuana, don't people look stupid when they repeat Health Canada stupid stuff, eh? By Health Canada, and it reflects the appropriate dosage identified in scientific literature, says the judge. They told him so. They testified in front of him. Scientific literature says 1 to 3, and he bought it. I couldn't tell him otherwise. Justice Crampton knew about the fraud, but he didn't let me be there. As stated above, every judge who read my affidavit knew about the fraud and didn't let Manson know about it. As stated above, the harm alleged must not be hypothetical or speculative. Well, this ain't. It cannot be comprised of generalized assertions, no minor statistics, unsupported by evidence, and it must be real and substantial. Well, we use their own numbers, right? However, harm that will occur in the future does not necessarily mean harm is speculative. Instead, it's the likelihood of harm, my probabilities, not its futurity, which is the touchstone. Paragraph 59 of this alludes to a wrinkle in the end. The ability to compensate in damages, a traditional measure of what constitutes repairable harm, is complicated in constitutional cases, as the damages are presumptively unavailable against the government for enacting unconstitutional legislation in the absence of bad faith, fraud, or abuse of power. So, we have bad faith. That means your compensation claims against the government can go through, right? You tore down your grow up? These guys lied? All right. I consider the applicant's citation to be apt. It is appropriate to assume that the financial damage will be suffered by an applicant following refusal of belief, even though capable of quantification, it constitutes irreparable harm. Paragraph 89. Turning to the evidence, I agree with the respondent. There's inadequate evidence to show that there will be an insufficient supply of marijuana under the MMPR. Gee, I guess he didn't notice the testimony that said they had 1,500 keys. And I guess he didn't work out the monthly average to get 15,000 keys before he said there is inadequate evidence that he was shown. Actually, he was shown adequate evidence. It was inadequate evidence that he had seen. Mr. Kane details in his affidavit the steps Health Canada took to forecast this demand and various contingencies put forth to get their 1,500 keys. But he didn't actually divide the note to find out it's 15,000 keys needed, did he? Including stockpiling marijuana and arranging for imports if necessary. The applicant's argument with regard to supply amount to nothing more than speculative assertions. And mine is 1,500, don't handle 15,000. Especially when you're delivering it 9 times too slow, right? Same flaw affects both regimes. The applicants have also failed to prove that the 150-gram personal possession limit imposed by the MMAR would constitute irreparable harm. Because our motion was not on the docket to point out Health Canada's fraudulent evidence, Manson has now based his ruling on Health Canada's perjured testimony. His 150-gram monthly limit derived from Health Canada's average 2-gram per day survey samples is actually 9 times too low. Right, Your Honor? Given the true population mean is 18, not 2, oh, average 1 and 3, a month's supply for the average patient would be 540 grams rather than 60, 30 to 90. And given Health Canada's 2.5 safety factor for those dosages above average, that would be not 150 grams max per delivery, but 1,350 grams max. 18 to 2, 1,350 to 150. Get how that works? Health Canada offers supply 9 times too slow, an underestimate of 89%. And that's about how much they missed in their supply of marijuana coming up to April Fools, when they would have been screwed if Conroy's motion hadn't saved them. As well, none of the allied plaintiffs are large users, while Lawrence Cherniak's latest prescription was for 200 grams a day. How could Justice Manson have explained a 150 gram limit to those with prescriptions over 150 grams if they'd been there and Conroy had only small limit people there? Never even dawned on the judge there were people juicing it and wanted 150, 200 grams. Justice Manson noted in paragraph 55 that despite a daily average of 18 grams a day, the judge knew it. Health Canada's retail sales were 1 to 3 grams a day. Get it? Health Canada's retail sales matched what they say their surveys were telling them. And yet, throw in self-production, and it's 18 grams a day actual medical need. Get it? So I said for the judge to impose on the group a new limit based on not actual total volume prescribed, but on retail sales, with the homegrown production excluded, was a serious misunderestimate of the true demand, Your Honor. Given Health Canada has, sorry, Crampton didn't let you know. Given Health Canada has no peer-reviewed surveys upon which to base their regularly cited 2 grams a day average of averages, when objective data was always available of the average being 18, it submitted the 150 gram limit on the amount of cannabis possessed and shipped has been set 9 times too low based on false and misleading testimony and evidence. Finally, poor no longer have affordable access to self-grow, because it's in a genocide charge. I can throw that one in. Letting the MMAR expire has left all Canadians who cannot afford MMPR prices unable to grow an affordable supply for themselves legally, and most will be compelled to face the Parker predicament, health or jail, which was ruled in violation of Section 7 of the Charter. Failing to safety the sick among the poor with the sick among the rich inflicts on the poor group conditions of life calculated to bring about its physical destruction. And then I go into the genocide. I'll read it. The Criminal Code states, definition of genocide. In this section, genocide means deliberately inflicting on a group, the group, conditions of life calculated, you can figure it out, to bring about its physical destruction. And under medication is a perfectly calculable genocide. Health Canada's fraudulently underestimate of the average cannabis dosage required by MMAR and MMPR patients has induced Manson J to inflict on the group conditions of life calculated 8/9 to bring about its physical destruction. Failure to permit affordable self-production does the same. The Health Canada MMPR program officials responsible for this genocidal fraud are Director Stéphane Lessard, former Director Jeanine Richteau, Assistant Director Louis Proulx, Staffer Todd Kane, Minister of Health Rona Ambrose, and Prime Minister Stephen Harper. This affidavit is made in support for, and that's the federal court stuff. That's going to be what you're going to be bringing to your local cop to tell them why the 150 grams is hurting you. Okay, I go lay that tomorrow. Tell you more about that later. Now, tomorrow at the big demo, I'm going to be bring along blank kits. That means that you'll be able to fill out the statement of claim, run down to the registry a block away, swear your affidavit, shoot another block down to the photocopy shop, make 4 copies of everything, shoot back to the registry, and file your three copies of your statement of claim, get your nice gold star, take the number off that, your T number, and put it on your motion, pop on over to 50 O'Connor or another block away, get your service, bring back three copies for the court, file it, and you're done. You file your originating notice, and you file your motion for your interim relief by telephone conference call for personal use. And that's how quickly we're going to run through the system from the April Fool demo. And that's going to be an April Fool on them. They wouldn't give me a hearing so I could deal with the people who were signed up so far, get it all over with once. Now they're going to have to do them one at a time. They might have thought they could handle 130 conference calls. You know, a number of new people has died down. But the point is, after tomorrow, when we don't get our hearing, boom, they could be facing a couple of hundred new ones. And we're going to run them through there all day. As fast as people want to fill out a blank kit, run them across the street, and in 20 minutes, they've got a nice gold star to be waving on the hill with everybody else. So, here is my sign that I'm going to have on the hill. I am going to have this one and this one. Okay. That's what it's going to look like. Blown up four times on big pasteboard. It's a double pasteboard. And this one says, I'll just read it to you. Turmel's Gold Star Team 4, MMAR, MMPR, Repeal. Conroy's Coalition against MMAR, MMPR, Repeal. Flawed MMAR, MMPR means no CDSA prohibitions. Fixed MMAR, MMPR means valid CDSA prohibitions. Conroy wants MMPR fixed. Turmel wants it condemned. Then I list all of the torts, and I have Conroy's and mine. In the first big 10, he's got one, dry. Then I list the other ones here. These are specific against MMPR and specific against MMAR, and of those, he's got three. He's got the outdoors and the no indoors and the 150 grams. No licensed, what can I say? All the no doctor's issues, all the other problems we had, the destruct orders he didn't.